Good evening, everyone. We're a couple of little glitches here as we begin. Just give us a second, let everyone in. All right, let's go ahead and begin. Good evening, thanks for joining me for a few updates. It's really hard to believe that it's been 1 year, just about, when COVID forced a decision to suspend in-person classes and we finished the semester remotely. We all remember that, except our first year students who may not remember, but I'm sure they also have their traumatic experiences from high school. We made the decision in June to reopen the campus for fall and spring semesters, even though other schools were choosing to go remote. And we knew full well how hard it would be to operate on ground during a pandemic. And you know, and I know, it has been very challenging and far from a normal year would look like. But we made the decision in June because we believed our community is best served by being here on the hilltop as opposed to being remote. I still believe that today, and despite enormous hurdles, I'm thankful we opened in the fall and that we remain open today. It's taken a lot of innovation, dedication, and frankly, it's taken a lot of acceptance of what we can do and what we cannot do when balancing the safety of our campus with the need for a really good, positive experience for our students. And it hadn't been perfect, I'll admit that, but it's been successful because we're still here. We are all stakeholders in this effort. And let me say without hesitation, all of you are keys to that success. So before we go any further, I just want to say thank you. I know sometimes, you know, people say, well, it's the students' fault and this and that. I just want to say thank you. You've been great. And I hope you pass that thank you on to your friends, to your roommates, all of those who couldn't join us tonight, because we've come this far on this journey. I think we can finish it together. So with that, let me just chat about a few things. So first of all, as we do with every town hall, let me give you our COVID situation. As of yesterday, we had 4 student positives through on-campus testing this week. Usually the first 2 days of the week have seen our largest spikes. So 4 is quite manageable. For perspective, let's take a minute to look at the 5 weeks of the semester so far. Oh, I'm getting a signal here. Are we having issues with sound? Let's see. Just seeing if there's sound. Getting a maybe an issue. Okay, we're good. All right, good. Okay, I think they fixed it. All right, so let me just review our COVID situation. As of yesterday, we had 4 student positives through on-campus testing this week. Usually the first 2 days of the week has been our greatest spike, so 4 is quite manageable. Let's just take a look at the 5 weeks of the semester so far. We're fortunate to have low numbers during the first 2 weeks of the semester. In those weeks, we tested every student twice to ensure that we had established our bubble on returning to campus. In those weeks, we had a positivity rate of 0.38%. Unfortunately, the next 3 weeks, we had considerable volatility with positivity rates of 1.86%, a bit lower at 1.13%, and then climbing back up to 1.6%. This week, we appear to be moving in the right direction, but 3 days of testing is not enough to be considered a comfortable trend line. So as a result, the COVID analytics team recommended last night that we remain in phase yellow for now. We would like to push the weekly positivity rate to under 1% and stay there. And we'd like to push down our quarantine and our isolation capacity. You know, we're really straining that a bit. If you did not see Maura Marshall's communication on Friday or mine, please go to the COVID webpage at anselm.edu. You'll find a sizable amount of data and analysis of both. Maura also shared an example of several sources for our positives, including a cluster that began with a group of underclassmen who went out to a restaurant, a cluster from a group of underclassmen who went out to a bar, a cluster from a group of underclassmen who gathered in a residence hall, and a group of students traveling in a car together, and a cluster originating from a student whose parents came to visit from outside of the region. I'd also share, because I get questions about athletics in every town, that none of the positives appear to be the result of athletic activities. Yes, let me confirm, student athletes have tested positive, but like all other student positives, they have derived from social gatherings. I know you're going to socialize, and all I'm asking you to do is to do so in a responsible manner. We're heading into a very delicate time when it comes to COVID, a time when the vaccine rollout may make us feel a little bit more complacent. Just keep our guard up a little bit longer. I know you're tired. I know you're sick of hearing me say this, but hang in there. We can do this just a little bit longer. We have two big hills to climb. The first is next week with St. Patrick's Day, and the second is mid-April with Easter. Both pose considerable risk of COVID spread on campus. So it's up to us really to prevent it. We all know what needs to be done. Let's keep pushing. The weather is improving. In fact, tomorrow is supposed to be in the 60s. That's great. And the vaccine is coming. Things are going to get better. I promise you. So just hang in there a little bit longer, please. I just want to give you a quick update. I made some changes in our academic leadership over the last couple of weeks. Brother Isaac Murphy, who's been our Vice President for Academic Affairs, is going to be moving into the President's office as an Executive Vice President. He will be assisting me in that office with a number of administrative duties, and a number of administrative offices will be reporting up through him. I've asked Dr. Mark Cronin to serve in the role of the Dean of the Faculty. And I've asked Dr. Christine Gustafson to begin a new role, which is the Dean of Academic Excellence. And I'm really excited about that one because it really is focused on all of the academic support services that are related to student success. So she'll be overseeing the Career Development Center, the Melia Center, Study Abroad, as well as the Academic Resource Center and all of our advising support. So it's really exciting. I think these are great moves. I'm really thankful that all three of them are willing to take on these new responsibilities. And at the core of all of this, I will just assure you, is student academic success. We want to support students in every way that we can to be successful when they come to St. Anselm. So, you know, sometimes you don't interact very much with deans and vice presidents, but I just want to let you know that we're making these moves because as we think about our future at St. Anselm, it's going to be really important that we make sure that our student experience, that students have the opportunity for great experiential learning in addition to the curriculum. And so we're positioning ourselves to be really strong in this area. So again, thanks to everyone who, Brother Isaac, Dean Cronin, and Dean Gustafson for taking on these new roles. I'm really excited to be working with them. Let me just say a word about the Board of Trustees. They met on Friday, and during that meeting, they unanimously approved a capital campaign to support a physical home for the Grapponi Humanities Institute. You may know that the Institute, the Humanities Institute, sponsors the Come Friday seminar every Friday. They do some really innovative programming. So the plan is to renovate the current print shop behind Alumni Hall into a two-story space that that will become the hub of our humanities activities. With a highly visible central and permanent space, we'll finally have a home for a lot of experiences, including our classes, our forums, readings, exhibits, and small concerts, as well as weekly formal and impromptu conversations that invigorate our campus. And as we expand our partnerships in the greater Manchester and New Hampshire communities, we'll welcome organizations and creative programmings that affirm the rich variety of human expression. So just as the NHIOP is the go-to place for political thought and activity, we want the Grapponi Institute to be a destination for the humanities. That's our goal. Notable documentarian and New Hampshire resident Ken Burns has agreed to be the honorary chair of the campaign, and we're hopeful construction can get underway in 2022. So this project will fulfill the vision of the Grapponi family, whose major gift to the college in honor of their son and brother Gregory, a class of 2004 graduate, was given to establish the Humanities Institute. So this is a really exciting project, and we are so thrilled that we're moving forward with it. Shifting gears, I'd like to remind you about a three-part series, Reimagining Justice, which examines how policing practices and the justice system can change to better serve all the people in our communities. The Humanities Institute, joined with the Anselmian Network for Racial Justice, the Criminal Justice Department, and the Office of Alumni Relations to host this webinar series that's looking at current issues in policing and the justice system in light of our core Anselmian values, such as the engagement with the community, the pursuit of justice in all forms, and the fostering of human understanding. The first session in February, titled First Encounters, Police Stops and Race, was a huge success. More than 200 people engaged in this important conversation. And if you've been keeping up with the news, you know this is really a critical conversation, especially as the trial of the police officer charged with the murder of George Floyd in Minneapolis is beginning. This is really a timely topic. The next session, Keeping Watch, Surveillance and Race, will be on Tuesday, March 16th at 7 o'clock. Watch your email for Zoom information. And I just wanna remind you, it's free, it's open to everyone. And the third session will be on April the 6th. So these are really sensitive, sometimes difficult conversations to have, but I believe they're essential to our understanding of the many issues and angles and perspectives when it comes to race and justice. It is only through intentional engagement and action will we progress as a society. So I'm pleased that St. Anselm can be taking a leadership role in the community on this really, really important topic. I just want to end some of these updates on a really positive note. Baseball opening day, and I'm not talking about the Red Sox, but I'm talking about St. Anselm College, is on March 13th, exactly 1 year since we made the decision to close the college in the spring of 2020. Our Hawks will play a doubleheader on Saturday and a doubleheader on Sunday at the New England Baseball Complex in Northborough, Massachusetts. We'll be playing AIC on both days. So while you cannot attend road games in person, live stats will be provided courtesy of our athletics communication team led by the indomitable Griffin Spencer. Women's tennis will play in the Carr Center on Sunday versus SNU. Next week, women's lacrosse is home on Wednesday against SNU as well, which will be the first live athletic event to be held on campus in a long, long time. And it's the first event that spectators will actually be allowed to attend. Attendance is limited by spacing distances, and only St. A's faculty, staff, and members of the monastery and students will be allowed to attend. So no outside visitors, but if you're a student, you're welcome to attend. If you can't be there in person, you can cheer on your favorite Hawk team on your laptop. Home contests will be live streamed, so be on the lookout for lacrosse, women's tennis, baseball, and softball for that. With competitions resuming, we are increasing our testing cadence for student athletes. And of course, we're following rigorously all the NCAA and NE10 protocols. Personally, I see this as a really wonderful sign that we're on the road to normalcy. Honestly, to be honest, I'm going to be really honest, this Groundhog Day cannot last forever. And the idea that sports will resume on campus tells us that we're really getting close to the end of this very difficult moment. So that's a few updates, but before we get to questions, let me just offer this. We're really all fatigued by COVID. It's been a year since the virus turned so much of our lives upside down. So much have been asked of you over these past 12 months. This moment is historically bad, and it's taken so much to rise up and face it with conviction, kindness, and compassion. Please know, I see how much this has affected our community. Of course, we're not alone. The whole world is struggling under the weight of the pandemic. Every college is struggling with this. But it does not change the fact that our Hilltop has faced a challenge that at times feels almost insurmountable. So with this in mind, let me say two things. First, I see what all of you have endured, and I am inspired by your fortitude. Each of you have come together in this incredibly difficult year to make the best of a really simply unfair situation. You have shown what it means to be an Anselmian in ways that will be remembered by many generations of future Anselmians. And if I could give a shout out to each and one of you by name, I would, but we'd be here till midnight. So I guess I better not do that. But you deserve it for the great achievements of the past 12 months. So the second thing I want to say is, please have some hope. There are signs that life and moments where we can see normalcy on the horizon. It is so, so close. So let's remain steadfast for a little longer in our efforts to limit and contain the spread of this silent virus. I genuinely appreciate your perseverance and thank you with all of my heart for your good spirits and your goodwill. All right, so let's take a few questions and we'll go for there. Let's just see what we have here. All right. Hello, can we please have a mental health day again? I think it's going to the point where, to the semester where students need a break and we have a shortened spring break. Well, actually the whole point of having a spring break at all was to give everyone 4 days of mental health. So Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I've spoken to other college presidents who decided not to do the spring break or any sort of a spring break. And we decided early on that we knew from last semester we needed a break. And so that's the break that's coming up. I know, and it's positioned pretty well. I mean, it's kind of right in the center. If we can get there, you'll have a little bit of a break and just hang in there. But I feel like it's a good decision to have those 4 days, and hopefully you can have a break from your academics and kind of recharge a bit. Would it be possible to bring back skate night with limited occupancy on weekends to help limit off-campus travel? I don't know. I think if it's skate night, ice skating, the ice has already been taken out of Sullivan Arena at this point. So I'm sorry to say that won't be possible. Now, I will say that the Student Government Association is collaborating with us to really think about some creative programming over the rest of the semester. We've asked every club and organization to really double down on the programming they can offer. So I hope we'll see some more interesting and a few more options in terms of our programming on the weekend. But I hear you in terms of trying to have some really fun things to do, because that will help us all rather than leave campus. Do you think it would be beneficial to have students who go home for Easter to be tested before they arrive back on campus? So what we're doing is when they come back to campus, Students will be asked to, everyone's going to be tested again. So Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday after Easter, we will not be having classes. We will be having classes, but they'll be virtual, right? And so during that time, we'll be testing everyone. So, again, we want to reestablish the bubble after Easter break. Of course, we'd love people to stay on campus for Easter, but we recognize that some folks may go home. So that's what we're doing for Easter. Why is the pub not open yet? I feel like this would significantly decrease possible upperclassmen traveling to bars off campus. Well, again, the pub opens when we get to a blue or a green phase related to our phased opening this year. Yeah, so blue is the next phase. So we're in yellow. If we get to blue, we will have a limited pub opening. But again, we have to see some good trends. We're not asking for no positives, but we have to see some good trends, and we have to have a little bit more capacity in terms of our isolation and quarantine. So that's on the horizon. It really is. And I can tell you that the CAT team would love nothing more than to be able to recommend going to blue. So let's all work towards that. What is the criteria for the CAT team to declare when we can go to phase blue? Well, that's a great question. And again, it really has to do with how we're doing in terms of positivity. What's our quarantine and isolation capacity? And do we have the ability to contain? So what's a little concerning to us is if we get a number of positive cases that are not connected to previous positive cases or an outbreak, because then we don't know exactly if we'll be able to contain that. So it's all about cases, it's all about containment, and it's all about capacity. So that's what we're looking at. And trust me, we all want to be at blue and we'd love to be at green. So we just got to make sure that our numbers are going in the right direction. Can it be communicated with the dining class staff to be more forgiving when people forget to make reservation or a glitch happens? My friend just did not get to eat at Dave for dinner yesterday because she got turned away when she did not have a reservation. I think during this time, we should be patient with one another. Well, I agree. We should be patient with one another. You know, I think the dining staff have done an amazing job. They're trying to make sure that there's not a long line waiting to get into the dining hall, and that's quite a challenge. That's why the whole point of making reservations. The CDC has been very clear to us that we should try to avoid gatherings like that. So again, try to remember to make a reservation. I'm sorry that your friend had that experience, and I will certainly pass this on to the dining group. Thank you very much for your service. We really appreciate all you've done for us. You're the hero we need, not the one we deserve. That's hilarious, but thank you. I appreciate that. I think you all deserve a better hero than this one, but we're gonna do our best and we're gonna work as hard as we can to make sure that we stay open for you. When will the academic calendar for next year be released? That's a great question. In fact, we had a conversation with senior leadership today about that. And we're trying to move as quickly as we can on that to get that out. I know that's important to all of you. So hopefully within the next couple of weeks, but very soon we'll get that out. Thank you for you done for us, best prez ever. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Any news on administering vaccinations to students, staff, and faculty? Again, State of New Hampshire has said we're going to be a point of distribution. We have not heard anything back from them at this point. I will say it's a hopeful sign that the supply chain for vaccines has seemed to have gotten stronger. They're more available. So I would love it if we could get students and faculty and staff vaccinated probably in April. I don't think it'll happen in March, but maybe in April. I'm meeting with the Secretary for Health and Human Services for the state of New Hampshire in the next week or so to advocate for that. So
I'll just tell you, we're doing everything we can to get that vaccine for everyone. Any news on administering vaccinations to students, faculty, and staff? Well, just as said, we're working on it. I'd love to be able to get it here as soon as we can. Would make me very happy to have that happen. What about the students who live outside of New England? How will testing and quarantine work when they come back from Easter break? Well, we're gonna follow our state guidelines. If they have to quarantine for a set amount of time and take their classes remotely, we will do that. So that's how it'll work. But we'll always follow our state guidelines. Will spring break change? I thought the break was March 29th until April 4th. No, actually it's April 1st and 2nd, which is Holy Thursday and Good Friday. Third and fourth, which is Saturday and Sunday, and then Monday through Wednesday, the 5th through the 7th, classes will be remote and everyone will be tested. So yes, you have class actually March 29th, 30th, and 31st. So make sure you look at your syllabus on that one. Any updates on guests, parents being able to attend graduation? We are working on that. We put a plan before the state to state attorney general to approve. We're waiting to sort all of that out. We really would love it if we could do not only an on-ground graduation, but also have maybe at least two guests for every graduate here. We're working on it, and hopefully within the next couple of weeks, we'll get something out to everyone. Is it possible to push back the time of commencement until the afternoon because of the close time between the pinning ceremony for nursing students? Well, we've been assured by the nursing faculty that the time we've scheduled, 8:30 for pinning, I think, and then 11 for commencement is sufficient time. Also, we want to make sure we move things along just to not have people lingering around campus for health reasons. Will nursing students with clinicals on Mondays, Tuesdays, Wednesdays still be able to go to clinical the week following Easter since we are technically remote? That's a great question. I'm probably going to get myself in trouble and say yes, but I don't know exactly. I would check with your nursing faculty on that one, but it's a great question. So I don't see any other questions. Let me just say, it's thank you for all that you're doing. I really appreciate you being here tonight. And also, I just want to say what a great week. It's going to be in the 60s tomorrow. I already saw some t-shirts and some shorts today. It's going to be great tomorrow. Daylight savings time is Sunday. Don't forget to push your clocks ahead so that, push them ahead. And you'll lose an hour of sleep, but hey, we're gonna have more daylight, so it's gonna be great. Patty and I received our second vaccination shot on Saturday, so we're excited. We see the light at the end of the tunnel. I wanna push for everyone to get vaccinated. If you're given the opportunity to get a vaccination for whatever reason, I hope you'll take that opportunity for your own sake, but also for the sake of our community. So in the meantime, be well, stay safe, and I hope to see you around campus. Great to see you tonight. Good night.